Привет, ребята. That's all the Russian I will say, or Ukrainian or anything. So I'm really happy to be here. Thank you, the organizers, for this awesome event, and also the rest of the speakers. It's been really great. So yeah, I'll be talking about functional programming. I come from the Netherlands, but I'm originally from Argentina, and I work in Housing Anywhere as a tech lead. That's all I'm going to say about me. So why functional programming? Basically, today I want to share my experience. I started learning functional programming around 3 years ago, and today I want to share a bit of the things that I learned and that can be beneficial. Yeah. So, why for the people? Who here writes JavaScript as the main language? Or yeah. So. That's exactly why. We don't need to learn any other language like Haskell or Camel to write functional programming. As we'll see today that with JavaScript we're fully capable of it. And one thing, maybe you saw this phrase, I don't know, monad, monoid, endofunctors, these weird words. Functional programming has this reputation of being hard, or that you need to learn a lot of math. And although this can give us different reactions, maybe like this one, or even like this, yeah? And puts you in a crossroad of, do I need this? Can I write just code in functional style without learning all of those weird words? And that's why, for the people, we're not going to talk about math today, we're only going to talk about the practical stuff. So, yeah. And first, we need to ask ourselves, what does it mean to write functional code? When I started learning, I thought it was cool, and that's why I did it. And it, maybe it's a valid reason for some people, but I couldn't answer why functional programming, because for me it was just that. I was doing it because it was cool. So we want to have some other goal in mind besides that. We want to do our job better, write better code, so anything that we can learn to write better programs, that should be our goal. And if we have fun and it's cool, even better. So. First goal that I want to set today is write code that is terse, but still easy to reason about. What do we mean by this? We don't want write boilerplate code that has a lot going on, that is extra things only to do simple stuff. But we don't also want to go to the other side and write obfuscated code that we cannot even understand. So our code should be easy to reason about, and that's one of the things we want to achieve. We also don't want to reinvent the wheel all the time when we are programming. We can mention like dry or keys principles here. And the last one, and for me the most important, is we want to represent our problems in terms of generic and composable bits. So when we're programming, we're solving problems, right? Our applications usually are the solution to a problem, either for the business we work for or for ourselves. And we all know that if we split the problem into smaller things, it's much easier to then solve those smaller things and combine them together. So that's also what we want to do with functional programming. We're going to be talking about functions. So yeah, functional programming is all about functions. We'll see them everywhere. Just like in object-oriented, we have objects as the core of the paradigm, or we have statements in imperative programming. Here we'll see functions, but I hope that your reaction will be more like this after. Yeah. So the first thing we're going to say about functions is that they need to be first-class citizens. And we are not in a plane here, so it's not like fancy or with more benefits. It's just that they are values. So let's see an example. We have this definition of an add function. It takes two numbers and we'll add them together. And we can use it to define sum and store it in a variable. So this sum is stored in a variable because it's just a value. But if we think about what we are doing here, we are just redefining add. again defining a function with two arguments and passing them to add. So we could as well do it like this. Add is already a function that takes two arguments and we can store it in a variable. And this becomes a bit more clear if we take a look at this example. We want to add all the numbers. So we pass to reduce this function, takes two arguments and pass them to add. And we already saw that add does that. It's a value, we can pass it. So we get the first meme about our functions. They are not just regular functions, but they are first class. And since they are values, we can pass them, as we saw in the example, as arguments. So this takes us to higher order functions. Higher order functions are the ones that can take an argument as a function or can return a function as their return value. We saw this example already, and we can take a look at this one. So we have mult, it takes one argument, returns a function that takes another, and returns the product of those. If we call it only once, what we get back is a function. So we update the meme again. They are even more special now. Yes, they are first class higher order functions. And these two things, sometimes we might take them for granted because they are part of the language. And that's why I said we can do functional programming in JavaScript, because that's the requirement, higher order functions and first class functions. But the next one is more of a practice that we do in functional programming, and it's pure functions. Who knows what a pure function is? Nice, I can go. So, just for the ones that don't know, a pure function takes some input and always return the same value for that input. So imagine if we had random number defined in this way. Because we throw the dice and we get the 4, we return that. This is pure. But we don't always want this behavior for some functions. So we want a different number all the time when we call random, or they now as well. If we return the same timestamp all the time, a pure function, that wouldn't work. So for some functions, we don't want them to be pure, but in general, this is what we want. And the other part of definition says that they have no observable side effects when calling them. So what then are side effects? Calling the database or doing any I/O related actions are side effects, output to the terminal, interacting with the DOM, anything that is using global values. All of these are side effects that our functions can produce. And calling other functions that do side effects as well. And let's see an example then. Who is familiar with splice and slice? I usually get this reaction when I think about them. I'm confused. So let's look closer. We have a splice. If we call it, we get this, a part of the array, a few items. So here, the first three items. What happens if we call it again? That's weird. Yeah. What happened here? Why do we get different items? And if we check the value of our array, we see that it changed. It doesn't contain 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So that's not maybe not so helpful, in especially if we don't know that it's changed on an array. Now let's take a look at slice. We call it once, same result. But if we keep calling it, we always get the first three items. And if we check what's the value of a slice is, well, it's our array, sorry, it's the same. So it didn't mutate. So we can see the difference of pure and impure functions. And for me, this is all about predictability. If we don't know what splice is doing, we might be very surprised that, let's say we call it in an array of users, and now we have less or products, and we have less products displayed in our UI. So we want to, in functional programming, we want our functions to be predictable, right? But you might ask, what about I/O then? If I tell my product owner that I only write pure programs, and they are not going to do anything besides a calculation, but we cannot show them because that's a side effect. We cannot call database. So we need side effects, and we get another meme here. So the problem with side effects is not the fact part, but they happen on the side, so they are not predictable. Imagine you call a function, as we saw it with splice, and besides doing what you want, it also mutates your arguments or does something unpredictable. And there are many patterns that we can discover in functional programming to tackle this. And the first one is to write the application in such a way that we isolate the impure part, the part that produces some effects, and the rest of our application is written in a pure way that we can, for example, test very easily. If we recap the definition, for some input, we have the same output. And so we know what it's going to do, so this is really easy to test. They also don't produce observable side effects, so it means that we don't need to check any global value if it changed. There is no state going on that we need to check. We don't need to spy or any value or anything. So this becomes really predictable. Now, let's take a look at this function here, save user. It takes a user and calls db.save. And there are two things here. One, it's impure because it saves some database, but it's also depending on some global object, this DB object. So this is impure, but we can change it. What if we take DB as one of the arguments, and then we do our thing with saving to database? Now this becomes pure. We can even go farther by doing what we did in the first class case. And why is this pure now? I mean, the save part is still there, right? It's not like we did some magic and it went away. It's pure because when we call it with some DB object, it will always return the same function back. So we are delaying the impure part to later. And in production, we can pass the real object that we connect to that database. But when we test, we then can pass a mock database, and this becomes much easier to test. And it's all because we are not depending on some global object, right? So we saw our pure functions, and besides predictability and being easy to test, they have some other benefits. Since they always produce the same output for some given input, we can cache them, we can memoize. That's very good when they are very expensive doing some calculations, or we can run them in parallel. We're not depending on any global memory or any global object, so we can also run them in parallel. Usually they're very portable. We can share them across modules or projects. They're self-documenting as well, and especially if we add types on top. And this idea of pure functions goes a long way. There are a few libraries that are inspired by this. So for example, here we have this function that takes some data, and with that produces a view. I don't know if you can guess which library is based on this idea. Yes, React, exactly. And basically, yes, React has more things. This is an oversimplification, but the idea of React is this. We have some data, we produce a UI, and we know that for this piece of data, we're going to always produce this UI. So this is, again, very predictable. It's very declarative. And let's see another example. So now we have a function that takes some state and an action and returns a state. As I said, they are also self-documented. We can, from this, guess that this function is using the action to calculate the next version of the state. And again, maybe you already guessed, this is a reducer in Redux. And Redux is a very good example of what I said about writing our application in such a way that we have pure functions, and we have an isolated place where we produce the impure or effectful part. And Redux takes it even farther, because this is in a runtime, the Redux store, that is not even part of our application. So again, the meme needs to be updated. Yeah. Now, when we were talking about first class functions, we wrote one of the functions like this. So this becomes easy. We're adding two numbers. If we want to write an increment function, we just define add, call add with one, and now we can increment, and we get the 3, right? But this is not so useful or so common when we want to call it twice. So add numbers directly, because we need to do this. It would be great if we could do this, but we have a function, right? So we could then define sum in a different way. Instead of taking one by one the arguments, we take the two of them and we add. So now it's more common, not only the definition of the function to what we are used to, but also to call it. But if we want to implement increment in this way, we need to do more work. So we're going to sum 1 and b, and now we can increment. And so we can see benefits from each approach. And this takes us to covering and partial application. We already had lunch, so you're not going to think about Indian curry here. It's only curry is a technique of taking a function that takes several arguments and returning a sequence of functions that takes one argument at a time. And we'll see examples so it becomes more clear. And partial application is related to it. It's what we did, for example, here in the ink. We are partially applying the first number, and we have a function that will take the next argument. So it would be nice if we could do both things. This is, of course, failing because add now is not a function here. So let's implement then a way to solve the problem. We can curry our function, so it takes one argument at a time. But if we want, we should be able to pass the two arguments at once. So I'm going to define curry. It takes a function, and it will return also a function. Of course, it doesn't work if we return the same one. So we need to find what function to return here. We're going to take several arguments, so we can use a spread for that. And based on some condition, we are going, if this is true, we just call our function with all the arguments. That's great. If it's not true, then it means we didn't have all the arguments yet. We can partially apply the first part. But now, and we can also query the result. And now we need to find out about this condition here. So we have the arguments, and we can know its length, right? And so it happens to be that functions have also a length property, and it's the amount of arguments it was defined with. So if the arguments that we got in our updated functions are the same of the original one, the amount, then it works. So now we can call it with one argument and then pass the other one, or we can call it with both arguments together, and the definition is simpler because we define all arguments as one. And just to see if it's working properly, let's define a volume function. It will be curried as well. It takes x, y, and z, and it will return the product of those. And now we can do volume of 1, 2, and 3, or 4. But we can also call it like this, or even like this, and it's working. We could store this first application in a variable and then call it. And I will show a bit more in practice the use of curry. So at the beginning, you may remember I said we are not going to talk about math today. We don't need it. But actually, I have a formula here. Does anybody know what this means? Composition, yes. So that's the only math, don't worry. No monads or anything. So this is function composition. And for me, this is the core of functional programming. We said at the beginning we wanted to compose or combine smaller pieces. And we start to see it here with composition. So let's see what's going on here in this example. We have a head function. It takes an array and returns the first item, and a reverse function. We define it in such a way that it's not mutating an array. And we define last as just using those two functions. First we reverse, then we take the head, and that's the last item. Now, if we see the compose definition here, it's very similar to what we did manually in last. So basically, we are composing our two functions. So we could as well define a compose function. It will take two functions that we're going to compose. It takes the value and at first calls the write function. And with the result of that, it calls the left one. So now we can implement our compose, our last, in such way. So we first reverse, and then we take the head. And what we start see here with compose is that we're going to be building our applications in pipes. Basically, a composition is just a pipe of different functions. We give data, they will transform it, and return the result back. So we can keep adding. Let's say we're now working on the title for the conference website, Odessa Rocks. Yeah. And now we have our compose function. We have join. We define it in such a way that first we take the delimiter, and then we take the array. It's curried, so we can first pass the delimiter, and now we can join any array we want. But as you see here, we need, because compose works only for two functions, we need to keep composing. And that's fine, but it's not very handy. So we're smart. We can say, OK, let's compose three functions. So now we add age, and we first call it here. And now we are good to go, right? Now we can compose three functions. But probably by now, you are getting the idea of what's going to happen next. We need to add another function. So again, we need to keep nesting this compose. What we added here is the H1 because it's a website, so it needs to be a title. And we could do it in different ways. Instead of using compose three, we could compose three times. So we could add compose here, and it's working. But again, this is not so handy as well. So what if our compose would work in such a way that we can pass as many arguments as we want? Now it's only calling the first show, so we get this weird result. And let's see if we can find a way to then define compose. So now, again, we don't know the amount of functions. We take a list, and we get our value as well. So what do we do with these functions? First of all, since it goes from right to left, or from the bottom to the top, we're going to reverse the array. And then we need to get one value as a result. So what can we use for producing one value out of an array? We can use reduce for that. So reduce takes two arguments. First one is a function, and second one is the initial value, which is going to be the value we're given. And this function sometimes is tricky if we are not so familiar with reduce. The first argument it gives us, it's an accumulator, the value we're generating. And the second one is the current item. And in this list of functions, it's going to be a function. So to get the next value to pass to the next function, what we can do is basically call our function. It's the only thing we can do. Yeah. So now it works. We can compose as many functions as we want. We could keep adding exclamation marks here because we think conference is really great. Or we could add some other ones as well. And one thing we could improve here is that we are reversing and then reducing, but there is already a reduce write function that does it for us. So you see here we started from composing small functions that don't have a lot of meaning for our application. They're very generic. We can use it for different operations, and we start to get in some business logic in here. So, for example, we are generating the title. We could compose it and generate the footer as well and compose those together. And this takes us to what I believe is the core of functional programming. There is this great talk from Scott Laschin. I hope I'm pronouncing his last name right. And he says that composition is fractal there. The talk is called Functional Programming Design Patterns. I really recommend it. And well, what is a fractal? It's a structure that it repeats itself infinitely. So we can do the same with composition. We saw it with in our examples. We have small operations, very simple, very generic, works with different types of data that we can reuse across the functions. We can start composing them together. For example, we compose head and reverse to build last, or we can compose some others and build some services. We start to see some business logic in here. We're solving problems for our application. And when we compose these services, we get use cases. And basically, an application is a composition of use cases, right? So for me, this is the core of functional programming. We take these small pieces, we can test them in isolation, we can compile them, test them again, combine them and have applications, and we can take even harder and say that if we combine several applications, we have a system. And maybe this composition is not going to be exactly composed. There are other ways that we can learn, that we can find how to compose different structures and add control flow there and other things, but the main idea is still the same. We're combining, composing small pieces. So what does it mean to write functional code? We saw purity, how it's easy to test. We saw composition. We can create our application in such a way. And for me, that's what it means to write functional programming code. But this is a question that I cannot only answer for myself. This is something I want to leave you all with. I hope you got some excitement for functional programming, and this also can be a way to get started with it. And one important thing I want to say is that only you can stop object-oriented, so yeah. And if you have any questions, you can find me or find me on Twitter. I'll be around after the talk. I also want to give credit to these people here. I reference some of their work. It's really great. The first book I really recommended, Professor Frisbee, Most Likely Guide to Functional Programming, is also in JavaScript. Yeah, so thanks.